When it comes to building information modeling, one thing is for sure. People have many different points of view. While we might not be able to agree with our definitions of building information modeling, I think we can all agree that people have been building buildings for quite a long time. Here's an excerpt from the Hammurabi Code from 4,000 years ago. Since that time, we've become pretty effective in communicating our vision. Here's an example of a major innovation in designing, and here we're looking at a plan, an elevation, and a section. The really great thing about this plan, elevation, and section presentation is that it allowed everyone on the project team to make a mental model of the building that was going to be built. Each different specialty could bring the items of interest that they needed to know about. Most of the time, that communication was pretty clear because we got good at understanding what every other person meant by their own drawings. Here's an example of some drawings with a call out for a particular detail of a corner. Now, this corner, there's some stairs going up into a building. And then the detail is with the stairs and the wall. Sometimes, though, people misinterpreted what was on the drawings. So here's the actual construction of that callout, built right into the sidewalk. Despite the problems with drawing interpretation, we continue to use drawings. In fact, more drawings now than ever before, because it's just so easy to print them all out. Designers aren't the only ones that are required to deliver tons of paper. Here's an example of pallets delivered to a facility after the handover of the building. If we were to ever try to move away from getting paper documents to electronic information about buildings, just consider the volume of information that we would have to capture somehow in an electronic format. Even if we could get all of that information funneled down onto some electronic media, it's not even clear the kind of media that would last and would stand the test of time. Would the programs we use 20 years from now even allow us to open the files that contain that information? Then, of course, there's the question of what information is it that we're actually going to capture. Consider this very simple example of a masonry wall with a brick veneer. What information do we capture? For most of us, just thinking about these kinds of problems gives us an enormous headache. If you're struggling with these kinds of questions today, it's important to keep in perspective the difficulty of what we're trying to accomplish with putting building data into electronic format. It took 30 years for letters and numbers and some symbols to become what we consider to be ASCII today. And if you think about ASCII, it's just what makes our technology work. We've completely ignored all of the effort required to create this essential exchange format. So in a way, what we're really trying to develop is an ASCII for buildings, and we're all struggling to come up with the magic format that's going to allow that to take place. Right now, we have to spend a lot of our time trying to figure out how to glue data together from one system to another. This is kind of like what was the case with computer systems before ASCII. But all is not lost, because we now are seeing the emergence of an ASCII for buildings. And it's called the United States National BIM Standard, based on open standard formats that are used by software systems to exchange information among one another. The National BIM Standard defines the contents of the information that needs to be exchanged for different kinds of purposes. Now that this National BIM Standard has begun to be used around the world, owners are taking parts of this standard, as shown by the COBie example here, and beginning to develop performance-based standards for the delivery of building information. These open information standards, combined with performance-based specifications, allow project teams to begin to think about information as just another deliverable that has to be exchanged in the course of a project. This YouTube channel can help you understand the technical details of the standards and their application to your projects. So I hope you'll take the time to learn a little bit more by subscribing to this YouTube channel and also by contacting me, Bill East, at any of the links shown on this page. Thanks.